Welcome to lecture 4 of mathematical modeling and simulation. So let's begin. In this lecture, we are going to look at a very important class of models known as population growth models. So firstly, we'll be understanding two terms, growth and decay. And then I'll be giving you the example of simplest possible population model, which is the linear one, and we will be calling it model 1. And then we'll talk about a generalization of model 1 to model 2, and then a further generalization of model 2 to model 3. So I'll be explaining you the meaning of the word generalization as well as we progress throughout the lecture. So let's first understand what is growth and decay. So if you go by their literal meanings, so it's very easy to understand that growth means something which is rising and decay means something which is decreasing, which is falling. And usually in most of the examples, we are looking at the growth and decay of certain physical quantities with respect to time. That what is happening to a particular thing with respect to time, either it is rising or it is decaying. So that's all about the meaning of growth and decay. And if you talk about the examples, then I could not find a better example, as you all are aware with the current coronavirus global pandemic. And this data has been taken, and you can see that this is a total number of cases in India up to June 4. The data is showing you that the number of cases is growing with respect to time. So obviously this side we are talking about time. So the total number of cases is on a rise. And if you want to have an example of decay, so here is an example in which I have shown that the death rate from air pollution per million from 1990 to 2015. So this data has been plotted here for different countries. And if you look carefully at all the curves, that you see a decay pattern. Apart from this one, it first rises and then decays. But otherwise, all these curves are actually depicting a decay with respect to time. So this is a data-based example, that the datas are there coming from different sources. We plotted them and understood that we have the growth and decay. So now what is the next thing? The next thing is we want to mathematically understand them. We just don't want to look at the data and get the interpretation. The point is we should be clear with, okay, that something is growing or something is decaying, why this is happening so, and if it is growing, how fast is the growth, how slow is the growth, or how fast or slow is the decay of particular quantity which we are observing. So to understand all these questions and analyze that at what rate the growth and decay is happening, we want to have a proper mathematical model for the same. So that means the purpose of formulation of mathematical model is clear to us. We want to understand the processes happening in detail, what are their reasons and what are their consequences. So for that we need mathematical model. So we identify that physical quantity which is changing with respect to time, either that is increasing or it is decreasing with time. So after identifying that physical quantity, we go towards the next step. For example, in this COVID-19 example, the physical quantity is the number of persons. It can be the number of deaths, it can be the number of active cases, the number of recovered people, the number of quarantined people. So whatever is there which is measurable, so that one we want to understand how that number is changing with respect to time. So that's the meaning of identifying that physical measurable quantity, whose temporal change we want to understand. So after identifying that physical quantity, the question arises, which type of mathematical model should be formulated? As in the previous lectures, I gave you the idea of that there can be different kind of mathematical models. They can be linear equations, non-linear equations, algebraic equations, transcendental equations, system of equations or inequalities, theorems, differential equations or integral equations. So these all are one or another kind of mathematical model. So now we are looking for an answer to this question. Okay, I have decided to model it mathematically, but what type of model I'm going to formulate? So the answer lies in this famous quote by Stephen Strogatz. It says, since Newton, mankind has come to realize that the laws of physics are always expressed in the language of differential equations. So I hope with this quote, it's clear that what kind of mathematically model we are going to talk about in this particular lecture. So let's move ahead. We have got the answer that we will be formulating a differential equation to understand growth and decay. So that's the answer. What is a differential equation? It's an equation that relates a function and its derivative. So there is a function which is depending upon something. So whenever we talk about function, so we mean this, the basic definition of function. I'm not going to give you the exact definition, but just to recall you what is a function looks like. Fx. So f is the some dependent quantity or the dependent variable. So it is the same thing which I was talking about. It is the underlying physical quantity, and x is our so-called independent variable. So whenever we talk about a function, there is some quantity which is depending upon other. So if you change the independent variable, you get to see a change in the value of f. So that function involves it there. And obviously the derivative. So why derivative is coming into picture? Because now you just recall what is the aim of this model. The aim of this model is to understand how the quantity is particularly changing with respect to time. And if you recall from calculus that the meaning of derivative is the rate of change of the f with respect to x. So we know that f dash physically denote the rate of change of f with respect to x. So that's why derivatives are coming into picture. So these are the components of a differential equation. There's a dependent variable, which I've just told you the physical quantity. Independent variable, it's usually space and time, but today's lecture, most of the time, we will be having time as an independent variable because we want to understand the real world process which is happening in real time. So the changes we are observing are with respect to time. So our independent variable is going to be time. And then derivatives are involved. I've just explained you the meaning of it. The derivative is nothing but the rate of change of dependent variable with respect to the independent variable. So now let's start with our first model, which I told you is going to be the simplest possible population growth model. So one thing I would like to make it clear here, that although the name I have given is population growth model, but it's not specifically we'll be modeling the population growths. As I told you that the physical quantity can be anything. It can be the number of persons living in a particular area, how the population of a country is increasing with respect to years. So that's also a way of looking at population growth and how the disease is spreading, how the infection is going to rise. So although that number of infected persons does not literally mean the population, but still these models are called population growth model. So there's a general name population growth model, but it's not always necessary that the physical quantity is representing the population. So with that, I'll give you the first example. So suppose you have a bank account and you deposit a fixed amount of money per month in your bank account. So you can take it like, suppose it's your salary which is deposited by your employer per month in your account. So since this is a fixed number, so it's going to be a constant. So let this constant be denoted by K. So let K be the amount of money deposited in your account per month. So once you have figured out that this is K, now I need to model it. And for model, I need to define another variable. Let MT denote the amount of money in your bank account at any time T. because you start from some initial conditions. And then why you're mathematically modeling this picture? Because you want to understand that, okay, if I have this much money deposited in my account every month, then at any particular time in future, I want to know how much money do I have. So I should have the formula for doing that. So while deriving that formula, for deriving that formula, we are actually mathematically modeling it. So you can say at this stage, okay, this is very easy. You don't need to actually formulate a differential equation for the same. But deliberately, I have taken a very simple example so that you can understand the basics of mathematical modeling. So I've defined my unknown, the physical quantity or the dependent variable. It's clear that M is the dependent variable and T is my going to be the independent variable. So I just told you something which is changing with respect to another variable. So we need to bring into picture the derivative. So dm by dt, how m is changing with respect to time, is actually equal to k. It's a constant. Because why it's a constant? Because it's stated in the beginning that you are depositing a fixed amount of money in your bank account and that does not change with time. That amount of money remains fixed. So the rate of change is constant. So that's why this is the model, dm by dt equals to k. And what is this? Mt naught is equal to m naught. Here t naught is the initial time. Initial time can be zero also. For example, you start depositing it today. So today time you can note explicitly or you can just refer this time to as zero time. So t naught is nothing but the initial time. And m naught is the amount of money in your bank initially. If you start from an account which is having initially zero money, so m naught will be zero in that case, otherwise it will be having certain fixed value. So this is called the initial condition. So this condition is very essential to find the solution of this differential equation, as you will see. So this problem is also called an initial value problem. Although in general I'm calling it a mathematical model, but specifically this kind of models in which you have a differential equation plus an initial condition given to us, we call it an initial value problem. So initial condition means you are always given the value of your unknown. The capital M is your unknown. The value of unknown is given to you at a particular time, initial time. So initially you know the value, and for rest of the future times you want to understand it, that what is going to be the value. So these kind of problems are called initial value problems. So we are done with the model formulation. Now what is the next step? We need to check whether the model which we have formulated is dimensionally consistent or not. So how to check the dimensional consistency? So this is an equation in front of you. So I'll be computing the dimension of left hand side and of right hand side and see if they match or not. So dm by dt dimension is nothing but equal to dimension of dm by dimension of dt, and money is said as such is not having any dimension, so by dt means t minus 1. Similarly, dimension of k is t minus 1 because k is money deposited per unit time. That unit of time is per month here, so the dimension is t minus 1. So you can see both of these are same, so therefore our model is dimensionally consistent. So that's an essential step we need to do whenever we are formulating an model, a mathematical model from the beginning. So once you are done with it, so now the next thing is we need to solve the model. If you recall the process of mathematical modeling, we are following exactly the same steps. Firstly, we thought what is our purpose of modeling, then we modeled it, we checked the dimensional consistency of the model, and now we are moving ahead towards solving it. So this is a very simple equation. You can solve it. So dm is k dt. If you integrate with respect to time on both the sides, so it's easy to see you're going to get mt is kt plus c, where c is definitely the constant of integration. So never forget to add the constant of integration. So now how to find the value of constant of integration? So here we will be using our initial condition. So when you use this initial condition, which specifies the value of your unknown at a particular time, so you will be using this to find the value of C. So M at T naught is KT naught plus C. This gives you C is equal to M at T naught minus KT naught, which is M naught minus KT naught. So by using the initial condition, we are able to evaluate the value of C. And now, once you have found what is the value of C, you substitute this value in the solution, which we had obtained here. This was the solution, M at T is KT plus C. So this value of C you substitute here, you will get M at T is M naught plus KT minus T naught. So this is nothing but the solution of our mathematical model 1. So that's how easy it was for this very simple problem. We formulated it and solved it. So what is the next thing in our mind? We want to now analyze this solution, that what is the physical meaning of this solution, what this solution is telling us. So basically, I want to visualize this solution. So for that, let's once again write what is the solution which we have just obtained. This is M naught plus K T minus T naught. So in most of the cases, our T naught is zero, because I even explained this to you earlier, that T naught is the initial time. So for simplicity, you can always take it equals to zero. So this becomes the simple form of the solution. So M at T is M naught plus KT. So it's very easy to understand, because K is the amount of money which we are depositing per month. So suppose you want to calculate the money you have after 6 months. So it's the initial money plus K, whatever was the amount deposited per month, say it was $10,000, into say T. T is 6 months. So it's some initially, suppose you started with say $10 plus this. So whatever this turns out to be, that's your money at any given time. So that's obviously, we could even compute it without the mathematical formulation of the differential equation, but still the model is conceptually right. It is matching with the physical intuition we have for the solution. So what further I have done, I have given a specific value to M naught. M naught is equal to 10, which is giving me this. And this is nothing but, as you can see, I have plotted the solution for different values of K. See, once you get the solution, it's very easy to identify your parameters. T is the independent variable, M is the dependent variable, while M naught and K are my controlling parameters. Controlling parameter means, if I change the value of M naught and K, I'll get a different solution every time. So I have fixed the value of M naught equals to 10 here, and for different values of K, I have plotted the curves, and all of you can see are straight lines, because even without plotting, all of you, we can understand that the solution is going to have a linear profile. So that's the reason this is called a linear growth. And what is this K denoting? K is nothing but the slope of these lines. So because this is a linear growth, as it is depicted from its solution curve, so that's why this model dm by dt equals to K is called a linear growth model. So whenever there is a quantity which is changing at a fixed rate with respect to time, so this is coming out to be linear only because K is independent of anything. K is just a fixed number. That's why it's turning out to be a linear growth model. So dm by dt is equal to K is a linear growth model. This is growth because K is positive. So if K is positive, we call it a growth model. However, if K is negative, we'll be calling it a decay model. So the same model can act as a growth as well as decay model depending upon the parameter K, right? So that's the visualization of the solution of model 1. So now we want to be more realistic. So I want to move towards our next step, which is called generalization of model 1 to something which is more appropriate towards a reality. So with this example, I want you to explain with a very important step which usually is done while performing research in mathematical modeling. So whenever we want to construct a model of any real world phenomena, the first thing we have to do is that we just don't look at the construction of the model out of the black box. We just don't do it scratching from the base. We have to do it by looking at existing models. So you figure out any existing model and then try to generalize it. Try to point out a factor which was not involved in the previous model, and that will give you a more realistic model. So same technique I'm going to use here, that to be my model to be more realistic, I need to incorporate a factor which was not present in the model one. So model one was all about that the rate of money changing with respect to time in your bank account is fixed. So because you are depositing money every time. But in real life, we do not only deposit money, we do spend as well. So here we have some amount of money you are spending per month, and that is also fixed at S. So dm by dt turns out to be k minus s, because k is going to be added, s is going to be subtracted, because that is your spending from the account. So, and that is also independent of time. So S also has to be taken to be a constant, but this model is definitely more realistic than model one because it is also incorporating spending. And moreover, this is called a generalization. Model two is called a generalization of model one. What is the meaning of this word generalization? That if I put S is equal to zero in model 2, what I am going to get is model 1. So that means model 1 can be easily obtained from model 2 by changing or particularly fixing the value of certain parameters. So that kind of models are called the generalized models. So even if you study only model 2, then all the dynamics of model 1 can also be studied from the same. And if you talk about solution of model 2, so it's very easy to solve because on the similar lines you can solve it the way we have solved model 1. So it's just the difference is instead of k, there is the term k minus s. So I'm solving it exactly on similar way. So I'm getting the final solution is m naught plus k minus s into t minus t naught. And again, you can put the value of t naught equals to 0 for simplicity. In that case, we will be getting mt is equal to m naught plus k minus s into t. So that's the solution of model 2. Now we want to move towards the next step, that interpreting this solution in terms of real world, what this model is depicting. If you draw the graph of it, this is also coming out to be linear, but this time it is dependent upon the value of k and s. See, in the previous model, m naught and k were the controlling parameters, but in this model there are three controlling parameters: m naught, k and s. So let's try to analyze this solution in terms of the controlling parameters. Suppose m naught is fixed. So case one is when k is greater than s. That means you are earning more than you spent. In other words, you can say you are spending less than you earn. So eventually the amount of money in your bank is going to increase with time because the amount of money added is more but subtracted is less. But if k is less than s, then you are spending more than you earn. So in that case, obviously what is going to happen? The amount of money in your bank eventually decreases with time, and there will soon come a time when you will turn bankrupt. Because suppose initially you had huge savings, but then later on with every gradual month your spending is going to increase as compared to your earnings, so you will eventually lose all the money you have. So this is the physical intuition of the model, and it is actually matching with the reality. So the same information is coming mathematically from here, because if case one is happening, that is if k minus s is positive, obviously time is something which is positive. So m naught, the amount of money you started initially with, plus something positive, that means m is going to increase. But if k is less than s, so in that case k minus s is negative. So by k minus s is negative, your mt is going to decrease with time. So that means our model solution is matching with its physical intuitions. That's why this model is validated. This is correctly predicting what is supposed to happen. So here's a question for you. As I told you in the case 2, what is going to happen? That eventually you will turn bankrupt. So can you find the time taken by you in the case of k less than s in which you are turning bankrupt? So there's an exercise for you. You can try. It's very easy if you understand the meaning of the word bankrupt. So very easily you'll be able to compute that. So that's an exercise. Do that and get the answer. Okay, so the next thing is again one step more moving closer towards the reality. So this is one step more generalization towards the real world process. So what's happening in model 1? It was constant. In model 2, dm by dt was constant minus spending was also there. But in model 3, I'm supposing it a bit more realistically, that your spending is proportional to the amount of money you have in your account at that particular time. So that means your s is not constant while s is proportional to m. So mathematically it can be written as s is a constant multiple of m. So say s is r into m. So this gives me dm by dt is k minus rm, and obviously with the initial condition m at t naught is m naught. So this is my model 3. So you can see that by imposing or by assuming another realistic assumption, that we do not just spend every month a fixed amount, we spend according to the money we have. Suppose initially you have less amount of money, so you will spend less. But as your savings are going to increase, you will tend to spend more. So S is going to be directly proportional to the amount of money you have. So this gives me this model. So clearly, this is also a generalization of model 1, or you can also say model 2. So now we are interested in solution of this model. So here, because of the dependency of m in the right hand side, the solution technique is going to be a bit different. So I have used the separation of variables. So all of these techniques you have studied in your earlier classes, and very easily you can figure out the solutions. So dm by k minus rm is dt, and then when you integrate both sides with respect to t, you get log k minus rm by minus r is equal to t plus c. Small c is the constant of integration, and then you just shift it to the other side. K minus rm is e raised to power minus rt into e raised to power minus rc. So this e raised to power minus rc, I'm calling it capital C. So capital C will be found by using the initial condition. So when you substitute initial condition here, you get capital C is k minus rm naught into e minus e raised to power rt naught. And now you substitute the value of this capital C in the solution, you will eventually get your final solution in this form. Mt is k by r plus m naught minus k by r into e raised to power minus r t minus t naught. So this is not going to be difficult. You can do that substitution step and very easily you will be reaching this stage. So that's how the solution looks like. So it's no more going to be a linear growth. Model 1 and model 2, both of them were linear, but model 3 is not a linear profile solution. Its profile is going to be either exponential growth or exponential decay. So in what cases it is going to be decay or growth, that we have to see, but that is the solution we are obtaining here. So now I want to give you another interpretation of the solution, that instead of analyzing the solution directly, this alternate way of understanding the solution, which is called looking at the steady state of the system. So what is meaning of steady state? A dynamical system is said to be in steady state if there is no further change with respect to time. So that means your system has reached a particular stage when the things have stopped changing with respect to time. So mathematically, it means that the underlying physical quantity's derivative with respect to time is going to be zero. Because if something which is constant, so say your quantity is m, now it does not say depend on t. So in that case, it means that dm by dt is going to be zero. So that state physically represent steady state. And it's very important to look at the steady state, because most of the times very important and useful information is coming from the looking at steady state solution profiles. So let's obtain the steady state solution for this model 3. We have already computed the general solution, but now I want to know you that how to compute the steady state solution. So this is the model and this one is a solution which we have just obtained. So I'll tell you there are two ways of obtaining the steady state, one from the directly the model and one from the solution. So with both the ways I'll be computing the steady state. So directly from the model, you put just dm by dt equals to zero. This gives you m equals to k by r. And otherwise, from the solution, if you want to get it, so as time approaches infinity, this factor e raised to power minus rt minus t naught goes to zero. This again gives you m equals to k by r. So I can explain it again here. So the left hand side has been obtained from the model. When you put dm by dt equals to zero, this gives me k minus rm equals to 0. This gives me m equals to k by r. So this is the amount of money I'll be having eventually after a very, very long time, because then things won't change further with respect to time. So this is the steady state solution. And on this side, another way of obtaining steady state solution is from the solution. This is a solution which is giving me m as a function of t. But after a very, very long time, that means as t approaches infinity, so you remember this technique. Whenever somebody asks you to get a steady state solution from the solution, then you put t going to infinity. So whatever you will be getting is the steady state answer. So when t goes to infinity, e raised to power minus r t minus t naught goes to zero. Why that is so? Because r is something positive and obviously t minus t naught is also positive. So this quantity will go to zero, and if this will go to zero, so m will be just k by r. So you can see obviously the steady state solution is same, either you obtained it from the model or you obtained it from the solution. So that's how easy it is to obtain the steady state solution without even solving the model. I can directly obtain it from the differential equation as well. So now let's interpret this. The solution which we have obtained as steady state solution, m equals to k by r, we want to analyze this, that what is the meaning of this or what is the consequence of this. So this is, as I've just told you, the amount of money in your bank account after a long time. So that long time really depends upon model to model, how much time it takes to reach at steady state. But in general, this means this. So suppose m naught was the initial money. So this k by r is your final money, which is going to sustain in the last. So case one is if your m naught is greater than k by r, means initially you had more money. So that means money is decreasing with respect to time because initially you had more money. And case two is if m naught is less than k by r, that means money is increasing with respect to time. So that means these controlling parameters are going to decide. You see how beautifully the mathematics is giving you the answer, because here k, r and m naught, these are your controlling parameters. So you can see how these controlling parameters relations are going to tell you what's going to happen. So if you started initially with the amount and k and r, k is your earning, r is a spending proportion. So if that ratio you are able to retain less than initial money, in that case you are going to lose money. But if you maintain that ratio greater than the amount of money you initially had, then your money is eventually increasing with respect to time. So by controlling your ratio of spending to earning, you can actually control the amount of money which you are going to have in future. So this MT is K by R plus M naught minus K by R. This is a solution. I want to rewrite it in another way. This can also be written in this way. Taking T naught is 0, again, that's just a simplification. Putting T naught equals to 0, I can rewrite this as this. So the same concept, this case 1 and case 2, is better understood from here. That if M naught is greater than K by R, you see carefully at this solution part. This part is actually the decay part, because see, R is positive. E raised to power minus RT is going to decrease with time. So M naught is a positive factor. So if M naught is going to be large, so your money is eventually decreasing. And if E raised to power minus RT is decreasing with time, so 1 minus E raised to power minus RT is going to be increasing with time, because it's just the opposite of that, because of a negative and subtracted from 1. As time increases, this factor decreases, while this factor increases. So you can say the solution of this model consists of two parts, growth and decay. So if M naught is greater than K by R, so that means decay part coefficient is higher than the growth part, then your money is decreasing with time, while if the opposite happens, your money is increasing with time. So the interpretation which we got just by looking at the steady state solution, the same interpretation I can get from the solution. So that's the physical or intuitive validation of the solution of model 3. So now let's visualize the same thing. So for different values of K and R, I have plotted the solution curves. And these are the graphs I'm getting. So I fixed my M naught equals to 10. And for different combinations of K and R, in fact, I have just varied K, while R I have kept at constant at 0.1. And you can see from here that you see the blue curve first. So the blue curve is K is 0.5, R is 0.1. So K by R is 0.5 by 0.1, which is 5, which is less than 10. So K by R is less than M naught in that case. In red curve, my K by R is also less than M naught, so eventually money is decreasing with time. In yellow curve, I have deliberately kept it equal to M naught, so the things do not change with time. In purple curve, K by R is greater than M naught, so the money is increasing with time, as you can see the purple curve. While in the green curve, this is again greater than 10. So the money is increasing with time. So you can see these figures, K by R is a steady state solution, the amount of money you will eventually have. So this is 5. So you can see you started from 10, but you are eventually going towards 5. And you started with 10, but eventually you are going towards 8. So this is the value 8. You started with 10, you stay at 10 here. You started with 10, but it's going to rise to 15. You started with 10, but it's going to rise to 20. You can see the values over there. So this is mathematically, everything is matching. Even if you plot the solution, you compare with the steady state solution. Howsoever you want to understand the interpretation, all the things are having similar interpretation. So we have visualized the solution and concluded that this model contains both factors. The same model can act as a growth model, as well as the same model can act as a decay model depending upon the values of the controlling parameters. So that's all about these three models. In the next lecture, we are going to look at another important class of models known as exponential growth model.